Anybody who's interested in property investing or getting yourself onto the property ladder is going to love this podcast episode. Stephanie Taylor has taken herself from a minimum wage job to becoming a successful landlady and property manager within only a few short years. Her and her sister run the business together, and they particularly focus on the rent-to-rent strategy, which is when you lease an entire building, you take on the running and the maintenance, but you sublet the individual rooms and you make a positive profit every month just by doing that without needing to own the building. And in some cases, you might even get the option to purchase the building further down the line. This is a great strategy for people that don't have a large amount of money to begin with, but this is the way a way you can get into property investing and becoming a landlord without needing a lot of cash. And so he's very popular with a lot of people. And Stephanie also teaches people how to do this. So you can find out more by going to benlowrey.com/rent-to-rent-success. You'll find the link in the description. That's benlowrey.com/rent-to-rent-success with a number 2. And also, I've joined a property investing joint venture group, which is run by a mentor called Alex Louise. And you can find out more about Alex by going to financialfreedomwithalex.com. And if you know anybody else that would make a good podcast guest, or if you would like to come on the podcast and tell your story, then you can go to benlowrey.com/podcast guest and you'll find all the information there. Welcome to the call, Stephanie. How are you doing?
Good morning, Ben Lowrey. You are the only handstand teacher that I know, and I think that has got to be the coolest job in the world.
Well, I'm glad you think so, but actually recently I stopped teaching handstands because I wanted to pursue property investing instead. So perhaps we're coming from different angles on that.
Oh, well, maybe there's a way to do both. I don't know. Yeah,
maybe there is. I'll do anything for money. So, yeah, if you have any ideas, I'm open to any suggestions. So your website is HMO Heaven. And, I mean, we've loosely agreed to talk about property, but, like, tell us about yourself. What do you do and how did you get into all this?
Well, Ben, my first property, you're my first podcast. This is my first podcast interview. Oh. And weirdly, even though I do quite a bit of video now for the business, I've been so anxious about coming on the podcast. And I've sort of asked myself why. I kind of want to go on the podcast, but at the same time, I feel a certain level of anxiety about it. But partly it was originally a few years ago, it was because I didn't feel successful enough. And then I realized it's because I don't know what's going to happen and you can ask me anything. And so maybe I was nervous about that. But it's just these little fears in your head that come in and tell you lies. And it's like a constant thing. You think that when you've got over it in one area of your life, it spreads to everywhere. But it's a constant thing. And I was listening to your podcast this morning. What made me think of this is that I listened to one of the episodes that I listened to was Jack Cook.
Oh, yeah.
And what I loved about Jack's episode is he's just starting. And he came on the podcast and he really shared amazing value about dedication, commitment, you know, all of the challenges of getting started, and also the optimism and excitement. And it just made me realize that whatever stage you're at, you've got value to share.
Oh, of course. And by the way, it's perfectly normal to be anxious the first time you do it, because I've been doing this a long time, so I'm very used to it. And to give you an example, I would not know where to begin trying to arrange an HMO. If I walked into an estate agent or called a property owner, I'd probably be very anxious. And I imagine you'd be perfectly in your comfort zone there.
Yes, exactly.
So we're all in different positions. I hope to become competent at that, you know, fairly soon. But it is interesting how we've all got things that are within our comfort zone and things that are out, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I just thought I would share that. So a bit about me. One of the things that I thought, what should I mention today? Because I think I try to get past it, but I don't really talk about personal things so much publicly. I'm a shy person inside, although I have learned to be able to speak in public and do the videos and so on. But One of the things that I don't really mention, now that I'm more successful within property and other businesses, is that in 2014, I was doing a minimum wage job, and I didn't have faith in myself or confidence or, you know, even the vision or desire to want to move forwards. And a couple of years later, when I started the business, looking back on it now, the only difference between me in 2014 and in 2016 when I started the business, and now a couple of years, you know, a few years later, is that I just let myself believe it was possible. Mm. I let myself believe it was possible to have a different kind of life than the life that I'd had. And I think that's the one thing that excites me and that I want to share with people, is that you have everything inside you right now to achieve the success that you want to achieve in your life, if you will just let yourself believe that it's possible and then get out of your own way.
Oh, I see. So belief and mindset and things like that has been a big part of your journey, has it?
Yeah.
Mm. So just for people that don't know, I mean, I've seen your website, but I don't know a great deal about what you do. I mean, you're a landlord, or like, how long have you been in this property business? Just give us a summary.
So I started this in June 2016, and at that time I'd gone into it, and it was a bit of a leap of faith because we didn't have a lot of money or property experience, when I say we, it's myself and my sister who run the business together. But I wanted to have a bit of a different life. I'll maybe tell you more about this later, but there was a phone call that really changed my mind and made me think that I had to do it. I had to start my own business. And even though I didn't know if it would work out, or I didn't know if I could do it, or I didn't think business or property was for people like me, it was the thing that sort of pushed me to sort of give it a try and commit to it.
Mm. And I'm curious, what was your first deal, your first property deal? I mean, can you still remember it?
I can. So I'll just say a bit about it, because it's a little bit like what Jack was doing. Well, rent to rent is the strategy where you rent a property for 3 to 5 years and you pay the landlord a guaranteed rent, and they get guaranteed rent and freedom from tenant management, total peace of mind. So that's what's in it for the landlord. But we then get permission to rent out the property for whatever we can achieve for it. So we can rent it out for more money, and that's our profit. And so at the time I was living in Bristol, and I was coming over to Newport on Saturdays. I was still working full time, and I had a viewing one Saturday morning, and we went to see 3 properties. And then at the end of it, the agent just, I think I said the wrong thing to the agent, and she just really switched off, and so it ended on sort of a negative vibe. And I was then in the centre of Newport, where you know there's lots of letting agents right there, and I thought, oh my gosh, shall I go in to one of these letting agents? And I was nervous about doing it, but I thought, right, you don't get a chance to come all the time, so you've got to do it now while you're here.
Mm.
And then the letting agent that was right in front of me was, and that was open because they don't all open on a Saturday, was a big chain letting agent. And usually they're not open to working with, you know, independent people. And so I went in and I said, do you have any HMOs to rent? And she said, oh, is this subletting? And I said, yes, but with everyone's permission.
Mm.
And she said, well, oh no, we don't do that because, you know, we'd have to get the legal team involved and they don't like all this. We'd have to go to headquarters. They would never go for it. And so I said, oh, well, maybe it's just for the more independent letting agents that we work with who like it. And I said, but have you got any landlords who are on tenant find only? Because the agents work in 2 ways. One of them is where they find the tenant and they fully manage the property, so they collect the rent on behalf of the landlord and they give keep their commission and give the landlord the rest. And the other one is where they just find the tenant and then they hand everything over to the landlord. And that sort of opened the door, because from being very close, she sort of then started shooing me across to this big screen and showing me a couple of properties that were on the same road, actually. And a 5-bed and a 4-bed, and there were a couple of doors down from each other. And that worked out to be our two first deals with one landlord. And we just couldn't believe that we'd gotten started so quickly.
So the trick was to ask for the landlords who were just looking to rent the individual rooms, because they're your ideal kind of customer, is it?
Well, we were all asking for properties that were already, houses of multiple occupation, house shares,
Oh, I see. So there was some resistance from the agents. Are they kind of sceptical about this kind of thing, or what is it that bothers them about it?
Yeah, well, I think like everything in business and in life in general, if you can show that you deliver what they want, what somebody else wants, then they will want to work with you. Mm. So with agents, what they want is they want to get paid their commission. They want to get paid their rent on time. They want the property to be kept in great condition. Everybody knows all those things. But the other thing that they want is they want minimal risk. And because you're a new entity often, and it's an unusual option that's not always coming across, then that, as far as they see it, puts risk into it. But I think how you can get around it is to explain right up front and clearly, and using their language, that you're going to deliver what they're looking for, i.e. that you say that they will still get their commission as usual.
Yeah, right. That's a really good life lesson, actually. It's really important to understand what the other person wants or what's important to them, isn't it? And then if you can frame your offer in a way that fulfills what they want or alleviates their concerns, then you stand a better chance of making it happen.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's interesting stuff. Now, do you teach people how to do this, or do you just do it yourself?
Well, we were just doing it ourselves, and that's the website that you're talking about at hmoheaven.co.uk.
Yeah.
And on there you can see some of the transformations, because we refurbished the properties as well before we let them out, and that's how we can achieve higher rents. And so that's another advantage for the landlord, because sometimes we pay for those refurbishments. And the other thing that we do, so as we started doing that, and I started getting out there on YouTube and on Facebook with videos, little tips, because I was so excited, because basically I started all this at the age of 45.
Wow.
And I just thought to myself, do you know, if I had found this before, think about how my life would have been different. I really struggled as a single parent, and when Alex was younger, he's an adult now, but I just thought, how would my life have been different if I'd started this 20 years ago? Or if I'm passionate about sort of sharing it with people who think that property is not for them, or that you need a lot of money to start off. We were getting asked all the time. We were providing lots of information free, things that people can download to make sure that deal analysis is really important, to make sure the numbers work. And so we made available free, it's still online, our deal analysis spreadsheet, the letters that we use to write to landlords and explain what we're offering and make it compelling, you know, for them. And recently, because we kept getting asked, we were resistant at first, because I thought, oh, I don't want to be traveling up and down the country doing training or making that a huge part of the business. I didn't think it was my personality, but we started an online training course. And what I found is I actually love the coaching. I actually get, it's the thing, you know, there's some things that fill your heart with joy, and watching other people make those little tiny switches in their thinking that bring great results, and seeing other people achieve amazing things as well. That's what we love to do.
Right. So you've been training people. So that's good stuff. Now, let me think. One of the things I wanted to ask you. So you talked about going to agents, to letting agents, and I was going to ask you, and then you mentioned sending letters as well. So what's your preferred way of finding a suitable house?
Well, for us, we prefer the writing to landlords because when you're writing to the landlords, you're dealing with the person who you're going to negotiate with. You and also you're dealing with the person who you can deliver the most value to, because landlords care about their properties in a slightly different way to letting agents. And often landlords are really interested in the people, the personality, that trust factor in a different sort of way. And they're also interested in the improvements that you're going to make to their property, the way you're going to look after it, the way you're going to treat the tenants. So we like dealing direct with landlords. Having said that, there's two ways, main ways to get properties. And the properties that we're looking for are existing house shares, existing HMOs, and the second way is obviously through the agents. And agents have a lot of properties, so it is a good way. And depending what part of the country you're in, agents might be better for you than landlords. But with agents, it's also about the relationships and building the trust. But it just makes the negotiation if the agent is staying in the deal, because the property is fully managed, then it just makes the negotiation a little bit more difficult because there's another step in between you and the owner, and oftentimes you won't get to talk direct to the owner until that relationship of trust has built up more with the agent.
Right, so you can do either, but there's just pros and cons of both, just depending on the circumstances. Yeah.
Exactly.
And you're in business with your sister, so do you both have different roles within the business?
Yeah, it's so funny, Ben. Have you got siblings?
Yeah, I've got a sister, yeah.
Yeah, well, you might recognise this, but you might not. But I love my sister to bits, but she used to really irritate me. So if we spent like any length of time together, and the reason is she's so detail oriented, and also she feels the need to explain everything to you in great detail. So if I'm at her house, as has happened, and I get the frying pan out, for example, she'll start telling me what heat to put the frying pan, how much oil to use, when to put the egg in it, and all of this sort of stuff, because she likes everything done to an optimal standard. That's her way of giving love in a way. She thinks she's helping, but obviously it can be highly irritating, you know. I do know how to fry an egg at this age, but that ability to look at the detail and be able to tune into the detail and be able to set up the spreadsheets and the contracts and look more strategically at the operations. But she's the person who makes the inside of our business work as well as the outside looks. She's the power behind the throne because she's not often in front of the camera, although she's great when she's in front of the camera. She just brings something a bit different. And I'm obviously the one who's in front of the camera, the marketing side, the branding, the ideas, the vision, the relationships, and all of that. So I'm sort of bringing in the new business, and Nikki is helping the operations that enable us to deliver the business and also to be able to outsource the business through systemizing it.
I bet she's good at choosing interior design and getting the places right, is she?
Yeah, she manages the refurbishment, but I'm the one who designs the inside because that's sort of an idea, it's creative, it sort of goes with that side of things. But
Right.
she gets the refurbs and manages the contractors and the projects, the budgets, and
Right.
the very detailed things that we give to the contractors. Because like she doesn't just say paint a room; it'll say something like paint it. With this sort of paint, make sure that all the door furniture is removed, replaced, light switches removed. You have to say all this because otherwise not every contractor will deliver in the way that you expect unless you're very detailed,
Right.
and she's very detailed.
Oh, I see. It's a very good point, actually. Another general life lesson is, you've got to figure out what people's different roles are and different responsibilities and what everyone's good at, haven't you? Because, as you know, I've just joined a group and there's six of us and we're all very different. And as we move forward, we haven't actually done any deals yet. We're just about to. So we're at an exciting stage. You know, we're right at the start of our journey. And we've all got different things we're good at. I'm quite good at number crunching and spreadsheets and analysing the figures and the viability and that side of things. I've sort of got a general skill set. But within the group, like there's a guy called Wayne. I don't know if you know Wayne Farmer, do you?
I do know Wayne. Yeah, fantastic guy. He was in property before as well.
Yeah, that's right. And he's had a bit of experience with rent to rent. He's done things before. And so within the group, he's going to be good at going and finding the deals and networking and hunting out things. And then there's another guy in the group who's good at building work and project management, etc. And so it's really good. It's really important to identify what people enjoy and what they're good at and what they're not good at and what, you know, etc., isn't it? Because you just can't expect everyone to do everything, can you?
No, exactly. And we did the wealth dynamics profile when we first started out. Have you done that one?
Oh, I've heard of that. Is that Roger Hamilton's thing?
Yeah, it is.
I haven't done it, but I've heard of it and I'm loosely familiar with it.
Yeah, that was really helpful as well.
Okay. And what was your profile on that then?
So mine was a star creator supporter. Mm. And Nikki's, which is no surprise, is a Lord mechanic. And that, obviously that's very detailed analytical and all of that sort of thing. But can't run a business without the detail.
So by the sound of it, you've done a lot of personal development work. Besides starting your business, you've had a journey of personal development as well as that.
Absolutely. And that really is the most important part of it. What I've realized is that before I did any of this, when I looked at other people who were business people or were successful, I thought that they had something I didn't. And I thought that they knew things that, well, maybe they did, but the new things that I didn't know, and that because I didn't know that I couldn't start. But what came to me as an epiphany, and it's so obvious, is that you don't know until you start. You don't know how to run a business until you run a business. And you can find out everything you need to know because people have already done it. For every single problem, when we first started out, even the most minor of problems would totally flummox us. But now we're able to deal with those, and we can now deal with bigger problems. And we're dealing with the problem of we will be dealing with the problem of scaling our business. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that and some of the numbers involved. And that all the challenge of doing it. And what I now feel confident about is that we can do it because there are people who've already done it who can show us the roadmap. And that we only need to follow the roadmap, and then once we understand it, we can add our flavour to it and we can do what other people have done before us. So you don't have to know everything to get started, to take action. You can learn on the way.
Yes, 100%. And did you learn from somebody else? Like, did you attend some kind of training programme, or did you have a coach that got you started?
Yeah, the most important training that we had was not in the actual tactics, it's in the community. So when we started our coaching, the tactics is part of it, is an important part of it. So all of the things like how to write your landlord letters, how to write your offers to landlords in a way that's going to be attractive to them, that works. What to say to agents to make them trust you, or not to make them trust you, but to help them. How to come from a place of integrity when you're speaking to agents, because oftentimes when people are nervous, they don't come from their own truth, and that comes across as false or BS. And agents and landlords and people in general have got really high bullshit radars. Mm. So it's just those are the things we help people, the tactical things. But the reason why people don't do this, even though they've heard about it or they understand the strategy, is because of the mindset. And because to do anything successfully, you have to be prepared to fail. Mm. You have to be prepared that not every agent that you're going to see is going to say yes. In fact, most agents that you're going to see are going to say no. Because how many deals do you need to be successful? When you first start out, you need one deal. You need one deal, and you've got to keep asking for it. So the second thing is that to keep asking, you have to be okay with people not liking you or thinking that you're that you've changed, or that you've now gone too businessy or too salesy, or because people will criticize you because they've got their own issues and problems. And when you start a new venture, you need to tell everybody what you do, because the biggest ways that you're going to get deals is through landlords, through agents, but also through people who you know who did not know that you're now doing what you're doing, who've got friends or acquaintances who need what you offer and who can recommend you once they know that you do it. So one of the powerful things that we have people doing within our coaching is to start saying what we call the social pitch. It's how do you answer the question, what do you do, in a way that tells people about your new business. And people are often frightened, like I mentioned about me coming on the podcast before I felt successful enough. People are frightened to start saying I'm a property person or I manage HMOs before they manage HMOs. And so nobody knows, basically. So we encourage them, and we put people within this group and community where it's supportive and everybody's doing the same thing. And it normalizes the success so that, yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting you say that, because that's the stage I'm at the moment. I'm having to learn and assimilate that new identity, and I haven't quite assimilated it yet, because when people ask me what I do, you know, I'm in a transition phase. I used to say, oh, I'm a handstand teacher, I do this, I do that, and now I'm like, I'm a property investor, but I'm not quite, you know, I'm in that crossover stage, you know.
Well, I just encourage you just to actually say it. And actually you have been good at saying it, because you've mentioned it, you know, to me on the podcast,
I do like your perspective, the fact that so much of it is belief and mindset and all those. It's not just about how to instruct a builder or how to write a letter to a landlord. It's the self-belief and all those little things that really add up to a big difference, isn't it?
Yeah, and you asked me about the coaches. So the way we've really, as you said earlier, Rent to Rent Now is a straightforward system for us, and also we've employed a property assistant, Luke, who is amazing. He's incredible. If you listen to this, Luke, we really appreciate you. Luke is on holiday at the moment. He's in Ibiza for 2 weeks, and we really value what he does, because he's really worked the system well and added to it. You know, he makes suggestions, but so we've got that down now with on the Rent to Rent side. But when we decided to start the coaching, that was again where we came outside the comfort zone, because I was resistant to like putting it on social media and other places on my own personal page to say this is what we're now doing, because I didn't want people to. I kind of was questioning myself, well, who are you to do this? And so like I was saying at the beginning, it is a constant thing of constantly challenging yourself and growing your mindset. But we did get a coach for that, and the coach of how to put the knowledge that or the expertise that you've created into a system which can then be delivered by an online course. And you just think to yourself, that just seems like such an overwhelming thing to do. There's so many steps to it. And so we did have a coach for that, and she was amazing. Kylie Menz, if anyone listening is wanting to create their own online course.
What was it, Kylie?
Menz. So Kylie and then M-E-N-Z, and she's an Australian powerhouse. She's straight talking, and she really helped us to get to the stage where we had an online course that we could launch. And since starting out with Kylie, I've since worked with another coach who is an American coach, and he has an online piano course. And typically these online piano courses are lower priced courses, but he's worked on it for a number of years. And his name's Jacques Hopkins, and he's got Piano in 21 Days, which is a unique system for learning the piano quickly. And he automated his business and automated, because quite often what people do is they launch a course, which takes a lot of resources, time, and doing live videos or doing emails, and there's a whole load of launch process which you're quite involved in, and which can be quite time consuming. And he put that into an automated system. And I found him on a podcast as well, coincidentally. And so yeah, we started working with him, and that both working with Kylie and working with Jacques have really been game changers in our business. And although we're quite driven and hardworking, we got so much more done when we had a coach.
And is that course available now? Can people go and find it?
Which one?
That course you're describing, the online
Right,
course.
so with sharks, if they're just starting off, I really recommend
No,
Kylie
I mean, is your course, you've created some kind of training.
Oh, right. Yes. Sorry. Yes. Well, how I suggest people start, our course is often within property, there are 1, 2, or 3 day courses. You get all the information, but then when you're trying to implement it, which is the important bit, that's the bit where your mindset starts to go and you think, oh, this is never going to work for me. Oh, that wasn't a good experience. I'm not sure I want to try again. And that's the bit where you need support. So we've made ours into a 2-month-long course where you've got all of the information that you need available for you online, and it's the actual tools we use in our business. It's not stuff that we've made up for a course. It's the stuff that we use to be successful right now. And so they get all of that, plus they get weekly coaching with us, and they're part of our private Facebook group community, and that gives all of the things that I'm saying about, the mindset. That's one of the things that we focus on within that group. And the people that we have in that group are amazing. We call them the rent-to-rent stars when they're first going through the course, the rent-to-rent superstars when they've completed the course and stay in the group with us. And then the rent-to-rent rock stars once they get their first deal. And we're just seeing people going through the stage of negotiating and getting their first deal. And what I recommend as a first step, if you're listening to this and thinking, I would love to get into property and I haven't got a lot of money to start and I don't have a lot of experience, is to start off with all our free information. So I've given you a link, Ben, and I'm sure that you're going to put it onto the podcast. And so if you're interested, click the link that Ben's got, and that gives you access to our 6-step system to get your first deal, and that's an overview of everything. And also within that, once you sign up for that, you'll get access to some free online training, which gives you the 5 secrets to rent-to-rent success. There's lots of great information in there. And within the information you get with that, you can also book a call with me. That'll be included if you want to talk about your rent-to-rent goals.
Wow. All right. That sounds good. I am interested in that myself. So I'll put the link, like you said, in the description and people can check that out.
Yes.
I did have a few more questions come to my mind. I was curious, is sourcing a part of your business? Do you find the deals and then sell them? Or did you ever buy sourced, leads?
Right, okay. So I regard sourcing as the cherry on the cake, not the cake. And by that I mean that there's many people, or I hear people saying that you can have a sourcing business and have a consistent income. Now, for most people, especially beginners, that's not possible because you actually need a network of investors to sell the deals onto. And to have that consistent income, you need to have the deals coming to you consistently that are attractive deals that are not just what's available on Rightmove. So that's a skill in itself. That requires quite a considerable amount of marketing. And then you need the back end, which is where you've got this network of people who are looking to buy deals and who can move quickly. And again, that's something that requires time to build up. So I'm not saying don't learn about sourcing, absolutely, but just set your the objective that you will source where you can. Now, what I find works better is when you are in property, because you are doing other things that do bring a consistent income and can bring a consistent income for a beginner, that you, these opportunities will come to you. These opportunities to source deals, to pass deals on, to find deals will come to you. And meantime, you've got other income coming in. So while we've been working in rent to rent, we have had opportunities where rent to rent deals come to us sometimes that we want to pass on. Now, we don't class ourselves as a sourcer where we package deals and all of that. What we do is we will pass on the referral. So if somebody calls and it's a landlord that we can't help, or we're not, we'll pass it on. Like recently, somebody called me about selling their HMO in Lancashire, and I was able to pass that on to Nikki Talbot, who I know who runs PPL in Lancashire, who's amazing HMO manager, developer, and investor. So, and another person recently, we had a call from a landlord who wanted their property managed, and we were able to pass that on to one of our rent-to-rent stars, and she's now, that was her first deal. So she got her first deal through a call.
I see. So you don't focus on that as your primary sort of business activity, but like you say, because your network is in place and you're well connected, you know, these things get passed around a little bit.
Yeah. And the other thing that will interest people, and certainly I found slightly unbelievable and was hugely skeptical when I heard about it, was these ways where you can buy properties with little money, sometimes no money. And so we've got two of those properties now. So what happened there was it's called a lease option, or it can be an exchange for delayed completion. I won't get too technical, but what it essentially means is that the owner of the property sells the property to you, and I'll give you an example of one. We have an 8-bed HMO that we manage in Newport. And when we first started managing it, the landlord was having terrible problems with it, only had 3 people in it, was losing over £1,000 a month. And he'd been in that situation, or very similar situation, for some years. He had tried a letting agent, but because the property wasn't in amazing condition, the letting agent wasn't able to let it either, and the owner was also losing 10%, so went back to doing it himself. But you can imagine the mind, the feeling in the mind, his mind, you know, he didn't want to go there. It was just his stomach would, you know, clench when he just thought about it. So he'd been in that situation, and when he got our letter, he called up, but he didn't really think we'd be able to help. And we gave a few pointers. Well, if you do this, that, and the next thing, you know, we gave it, you know, a few step-by-step things. Okay, the flooring needs replacing here, there, and this is the colours to paint the walls. It needed a shower putting in. And so we did all those things, and then we took over the property. We put all the furniture in, and he was originally in negative equity. I'm going off the tangent. He was originally in negative equity. That's why he couldn't sell. But as we managed the property, he got a revaluation, and because it was full, there were 8 tenants in there and it looked good, he got a much higher valuation. So he wanted to sell, didn't want any hassle, didn't want to put it on the market, didn't want to organise for people to come around. We were able to agree to a price with him. And then how we're doing it is that we're paying him so much money every month, and at the end of 5 years, we can then buy the property for the agreed price minus what we've paid over the 5 years. So in essence, that 5-year period is rent free, because that goes towards buying the property.
Wow.
Do you see what I mean? And that's what is a lease option. So it means we don't have to get a mortgage now. Within 5 years as well, there'll be further cash flow. The property will have been tenanted for 5 years, etc. So it's a really good way, and we've got two of those. That the other one's a bit similar as well, and so that's an opportunity for you when you go into rent to rent, that you may get to buy properties without much of your own money.
Right, that's cool. Yeah, so those purchase options are a way of transitioning from just leasing into eventually owning.
Exactly. And of course, the other thing is, we haven't really talked about the money on this. And the cash flow, or the profit, if you will, on each property can be high because we really add a lot of value. So we're not taking money from the landlords. What happens is usually the landlords are losing a lot of money. Like in the example I gave you with the 8-bed, he was losing around £1,000 a month. When we came in, we were paying him over £1,000 a month. So that's 2,000 more actually than he was previously receiving. So we're then paying him over £1,000 and he doesn't have to think about his properties at all. Because he knows that it looks good. And he said he didn't realise what a mental stress it was until it was all taken off his shoulders.
Yeah, that makes sense. Is there any concern of this market becoming saturated? Like, are you worried that there's not enough HMOs and there's too many people chasing them? Or is that just not a concern?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Just to finish off the point with the chap I mentioned, he's getting over £1,000 a month, but also we're getting over £1,000 a month.
Right.
And that £1,000 a month that we're getting is value that we've created. We've invented that extra value with what we've done.
Yeah.
So that's why it's fair, and the landlords know that we're making money as well, and they're happy with it. Anyway, so going back to is the market oversaturated or even saturated? So essentially, that can happen. There are more HMO rooms in our area than there are people looking. And I think that is the case in many areas. And the reason why we're able to rent our rooms out consistently, and we don't take this for granted at all, we work really hard to keep it up, is by having the rooms as good as we can have them. Now, that, in our case, is not always the best because we're obviously refurbishing on a budget. We do it to as high standard as is possible within our budget and cost effective. And but what we can go exceptional on is the service. And so that's the standards that we set for ourselves. That's the standards that Luke is able to deliver on our behalf in giving our tenants an amazing experience with us. And if you Google HMO Heaven, for example, the Google reviews come up, and that has been really, it just lifts my heart every time I see that, you know, a review has come in, because it's so appreciated. We've got reviews there. There are mainly reviews from tenants, but some of our landlords have given reviews there. And some of our landlords have actually done videos. Robbie offered to do a video for us, and Nigel's done a video for us as well. And you can see some of those on our YouTube channel, which is Rent to Rent Success, about, because some people worry, why would a landlord want to work with me?
Mm.
And really, it's just all about the extra value that you can deliver.
That's incredible. You must be really proud of yourself, because you've become successful in a relatively short period of time, by the sound of it.
Yeah, well, that is the incredible thing, because it's the power of property investment and the right mindset. You know all about that through working with Alex Louise, and I know I really admire and love what she's done for herself and what she's doing now in sharing that with other people through the Money Boot Camp.
And I was sorry, I wasn't sure if you finished there, but I was gonna. What's your long term goals? Do you have very clear ideas of where you want to take your business and your life, of course, over the next 10, 20 years?
Yeah, well. I still do pinch myself at times, because I've now got a life that I didn't dream that I could have, but I didn't think I was capable of doing the things that I'm now doing. And in some ways I'm not. I've got complementary skills. I've got people with complementary skills who are working with me. But I love what we're doing right now. And I would like to grow HMO Heaven to be a bigger business, to outsource even further, because at the moment when Luke goes on holiday, you know, Nicky or I stands in for his role. So it'd be great to have another member of the team working with us. And eventually I can see that, you know, some of the people we're working with who are coming on our coaching course, they would love to have a ready-made brand to work with, so that when they go out to letting agents and landlords, that they've already got the brand. They don't have to set that up. And that all this back end, so all the software that we've got for the tenant management that we can do on their behalf. So that's one way that we could grow in the future. And the other exciting thing about it is that not only for the strategy rent to rent, as you know, you don't have to own a single property, but the exciting thing about what's happened to us since June 2016 is that we've been able to buy properties that are worth over £1 million. And again, in property terms, that's a very small amount of money. But in personal terms and what it means to me and my sister and, you know, my family, it's huge.
Wow. That's really cool. So how many rent to rents did you do before you did your first purchase?
Oh, I'm not sure. It might have been about 6 or 7.
Wow.
I'll just quickly talk about the purchases. So I've mentioned two of them, which are lease options. And we've also got two that we bought. And so that was partly with our own money, and it's not like huge amounts of money that we had, but I sold a flat, for example. So rather than buying an expensive house in Newport, I've got a lovely riverside flat. We're using that money to invest, or some of that money to invest. So it's something that other people could do. And often you'll find that once you put yourself in the arena, family and friends will say, oh, could I invest with you? Because they see that it's possible to have good returns. So some of it is by buying traditionally, and some of it is through the lease options. But I really, if people want to get into property, they don't have money right now, and they're looking at rent-to-rent and thinking, is it for me? It's a good way to get started, and then you can use that money to invest. So talking about the future, what we'd like to do is to buy more properties and to have more investment and to get ourselves into a position where we can use those properties for charities and to be able to serve people that at the moment we can't serve or we're not in a position to serve. We've started buying multi-unit blocks where it's flats basically, but conversions, so it's houses that have been converted into flats, and we've recently, our most recent one was a 12 unit property, one little commercial, and then the rest are they're not quite flats, but self-contained units with a separate bathroom. The bathrooms are shared, but fantastic potential, and we're really excited about doing more of that.
Oh, wow, that's so cool. And I've got so many questions. I'm kind of conscious. I don't want to ask you all the stuff that's in your courses, you know, because
you can ask me anything because people can get extra value if they listen to your podcast.
Yeah.
And ask away.
Okay, well, that's good. And people are going to go and look at the course as well and sign up. So that's fine. But what I was thinking, is it all over the UK or are you just focused in South Wales and Newport?
Well, that's the other thing for the future is the course, is that the course is called, you can find out more about the course at rent2rentsuccess.com. And the course itself is called Rent to Rent Kickstarter. And Ben, even if I told you everything that was involved with the course, people would still join the course for the community because it's the implementation within the community that really gets the results, that gets you to your goals, because we're even those of us who are shy, we're still sociable people and we get so much from being in a community that's supportive.
And that makes it more fun as well, doesn't it, apart from anything? It's so much easier to do stuff when you're surrounded by other people and you can vibe off each other, whereas if you're sort of just doing it in isolation, there's something a bit miserable about that, isn't there?
Yeah, exactly. And what I'd like to do eventually, because what I see this is actually bigger than property. Our mantra is yes, you can, because so many of us spend most of our lives saying no, you can't, or it's okay for that person, but I can't do it because of this, or we put the barriers in our own way. So I just want to encourage people, and I still encourage myself. I'm not at the full model yet, or if you ever become it, because you're always improving, is to have the yes you can mentality, in that I can work this out, I can get to know this, this has been done, this is possible, and you know, I can work towards being able to do it.
That's wonderful. And also, sorry, another little technical question, is there a minimum number of bedrooms or a minimum amount of positive cash flow that, you know, that you'll consider? Like, is a two-bedroom house just too small to bother with?
Yeah, so usually a two-bedroom, it would be too small. The reason is that the costs of running a two-bedroom flat will be, and the rent that comes in will probably cover the cost of the rent that you pay the landlord plus the bills. Mm. So there won't be any cash flow. Mm. There won't be any profit there. And that can be the same even if you own the property. It's quite similar for a three bed. Four beds can sometimes work, but we find that if you own them, they definitely work. But if you're renting them, sometimes the rent that you need to pay and the cost that you'll have mean that there's not really enough for both the landlord to get a good rent and for us to make a reasonable profit. Mm. So our ideal is five and above, and obviously the more bedrooms, the more of that is profit, so the more that we can pay the landlord and still, you know, make a reasonable amount of money.
Right, I see. So it's five upwards, really.
And you asked about the minimum cash flow, Ben, and obviously that is up to individuals, but what we do is usually say it's £100 per room per month, right, around that figure. But having said that, we do have some people who have come to Newport, bought properties, refurbished them. There's one going on right now, and they would like us to manage their property, and their property is going to be fully furnished, all mod cons and fantastic. And we're going to work with them on the finish and so on, about what's really going to let, but it's going to be cost effective as well, and what we see works in this area. And we're happy to take less cash flow for that, because we've already got all our systems set up and ready to go. Mm. And our cash flow is going to be similar to what they would pay if they went to a standard letting agent. But it means we don't have to put any money into that or any time into bringing the property up to date or dressing the property or furnishing the property or anything.
That's also cool. It's so exciting. You've got so many different... what am I trying to say? There's so many different strings to the bow, isn't there? There's so many, like, you can leverage, there's so much going on. I'm not sure how to say it, but yeah.
Yeah, there is so much going on, but I'm sure that you'll find the same, because there's so many different ways that you can go in property, Ben. And I know that it is exciting for you, isn't it, being in the group.
Oh yeah, totally. You know Alex, don't you?
And I do.
I've known her for a long time anyway, but it was only the start of this year that I joined her coaching group.
Yeah.
And she puts us through an intro period, and now we're just getting to the stage, as I said, that we're looking for our first deals. And so it's very exciting. I can't wait. You know, I love that. And also, like you already alluded to, there's a strong element of community. I'm really noticing this within the property investor landlords world. There's a lot of community within that, isn't there?
There is. There absolutely is. And yeah, you're part of the club now. And the reason why is most people don't do this. And most people, although they say they want to have their own business and they want financial freedom, they don't want to do what you need to do to be able to get there. Mm. And humans naturally will stay in their comfort zone because it feels safe, and we're wired not to like things that feel dangerous. Mm. And setting up your own business obviously has risks attached to it, so most people don't do it. So therefore there's a great sense of community, camaraderie amongst us as the 5% who are going our own way and forging our own path.
Do you envisage a day where you're going to do new builds?
Possibly. I had envisaged doing much bigger projects eventually. And also the other thing I'd envisaged is that, you know, at some much later point in the future, that lettings businesses are assets that other companies want to buy. So that's the goal as well. Have you thought about doing new builds?
Well, yeah, I guess so. I mean, at the moment, it's just anything's possible with me at the moment. I haven't got a clear, we're still clarifying our strategy, we're still figuring out what we're going to do. So it's a bit soon to say. But yeah, long term, I'm sure, given enough time, I'm sure we'll eventually, I definitely want to end up doing bigger and bigger deals eventually. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, cool. I really let me know about your deal if it goes through.
Yeah. And by the way, I'd love to, because I do filming for Alex. When her groups have purchased a property or they're renovating something, I go and film it. And you've seen some of the videos, I think. And so if you've got anything interesting going on, I'm happy to come down with a camera and we can produce like a mini episode and show people what you're up to if you want.
Oh, that would be amazing. One second, a minute. Just one second.
That's right.
Okay, I'm back. Yeah, I would love that because I do a little bit of video and it's always great to have help with it.
Yeah. So, just keep me in mind if you've got any seminars or anything particular that you fancy filming, just I'm happy to come and do that.
Oh, fab. No, that would be great. I have actually. I'll talk to you afterwards. I'll talk to you offline.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah.
So there's a couple of questions I always usually finish my interviews with. I like, who do you follow? Who do you look up to? Who's your inspirations, like authors or YouTube personalities?
Oh, I have so many. But I think if I talk about some of the people who you can just listen and be so inspired and who really changed the game. It's Les Brown, who's an American motivational speaker who came from nothing and has changed so many people's lives. And well, Les says so many things which are repeatable, but I love that it's possible. It's possible for me because when you start out, it's hard to imagine where you're going to end up. So when I started this business and looking back on a history of not succeeding at things, it was hard for me to start that and think that I could succeed at a business. And one of the powerful things is it's possible. Sometimes you can't say, yes, I can. But you can definitely say it's possible for me, and you can start believing that, and you can start taking those actions. So Les Brown is one, and the other one that there are two actually. So there are two books that I really like. So one is Go for No, which is what it sounds like, and it's a really thin book, and it just helps you to change your mindset about no. Because again, that's our innate hardwiring is to hate rejection. And that's why some of the easy things are difficult, like making those calls, going to see the agents, writing to the landlords, putting yourself out there. It's because of fear of rejection. So Go for No really helps to change your mindset around that. And the last one is The Slight Edge by Jeff Olson. And what that shows you is it's not those big leaps and those huge step forward. It's the things that you do almost every day, the little things that you do consistently that will make a huge difference over the long term. And I think that's reassuring when you're starting out from a place where the big leap doesn't seem possible, but the little step does.
Yes, I'm with you. Yeah. Good stuff. I think that's a perfect place to finish our interview. So thanks so much, Stephanie.
Brilliant. Thank you.
And I'm going to put all the links and people can go and check out your courses and your website. And maybe we'll do another episode in the future to update everyone on the latest news.
Brilliant. Thanks a million, Ben, for having me on the show.
You're welcome.